What will you experience at a Knock'em'd comedy murder mystery show? Suspense, excitement, love, more love, violence. Well, not really. And, of course, some music. Knock'em'd comedy is the number one murder mystery troupe, entertaining thousands of people for over 20 years.
Have a great night, everyone.
Their hilarious murder mystery shows are full of audience interaction from beginning to end that will keep you laughing all night long. Their shows are not to be missed. Knock'em'd Comedy's murder mystery themes include a mob show, a redneck wedding, a high school reunion, a family reunion with a luau theme, or your own custom show.
Johnny, you have a good time tonight or what?
I had an awesome time.
All right. She had a great time. KDC, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah, all right.
Fundraisers, private parties, corporate events, restaurants, and more. Contact Knock'em'd Comedy for your event today.
The Knock'em'd Comedy Radio Show, also brought to you by Two Eagles Auto Body. For more than 25 years, Two Eagles Auto Body has been the leader in auto body repairs and customer satisfaction on Long Island. Two Eagles Auto Body handles every type of auto repair, from custom applications and restorations to repairs involving insurance claims. So call Two Eagles Auto Body and ask for John Rossi at 516-328-2527.
Hi, I'm Danny Bonaducci, and you are watching Govs Radio. This is where you go if you want to see something or if you want to hear something funny. Coming up in just a couple minutes, this is a joke I told. What? I'm not on Gov Radio? Call the police. Call my agent.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Knock 'Em Dead Comedy Show. Happy Tuesday. Tuesday trivia coming at you soon. Thanks for joining us here on Gov's Comedy Club podcast on the Twitch channel. Please follow us on Twitch, follow us on YouTube, and share the links and tell everybody you know about all the great shows at Governor's Comedy Club podcast. Yesterday I had a bunch of women in here, some hotties. Today I got, it's just three slobs. That's it. Chuck is here, and Jeff is here. Hugh Murray, as advertised, is not coming in today. Hugh is our regular Tuesday guy. I'm assuming he's replacing Jay. I saw Jay, you know, because you know Jay is coming here every Tuesday. Yeah. And I was like, when are you coming back? I don't know. Come on. Son of a bitch.
What are you going to do?
Carol Miner is watching. Good morning, Carol. All right. So before we get into anything, I want to, because I don't want to forget, the last time we saw you, you weren't really seeing us because you had all sorts of eye issues.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I was a little wrapped up then. Right?
A little bit. Even had your glasses on, like covering, you know, and you're like, you know, I'll say it. I don't know if you're going to say it, but this is the moneymaker right here.
That's it.
You don't want to fuck with it.
That's it. It offends more people already. You know?
All right, so let's backtrack a little bit. What was the issue?
I had some stuff going on with my eyelids, and they had to take some crap off. And I said, while they're there, they're pulling all kinds of stuff and lifting things and pulling things. So they wound up making...
You had cosmetic. You had a facelift. Is that what you're trying to tell me?
Almost. Yeah. It's on the eyes, but they got rid of some stuff that shouldn't have been there, and...
All done. And I think you were pretty much done, like towards the end of it, when you were here and you were about to get the stitches or the staples out or something.
The stitches were coming out soon, and I was still all swollen. Look, it's looking like Fort Tyson. They were, you know, my eyes were all banged up and stuff.
It didn't look that bad that day, but I don't blame you. I mean,
was a couple weeks after too. So.
Right. And now, like, you can't even like I got to look close. Like I think I see one little line above the eyebrow, but I got to look for it. Yeah. Like, it's not evident or anything.
I mean, nobody's looking at my face that close.
But you're feeling good, and it's all behind you now?
It's all done.
I was with Don Sill over the weekend, and his daughter, she has two little babies, and one of them scratched her by accident underneath her eyelid.
Oof.
And, so she's been getting meds. And
Those kids can hurt you, man.
Yeah, you know, you got some grandkids running around, right?
Yeah, I got two here and one on the way.
Oh, you got another on the way? Yeah, didn't you just have the all?
Yeah, I just had one. And, well, I didn't have it, but.
Well, yeah, right. Your kids.
That was right on Halloween.
Wow.
Right on Halloween.
You got some busy kids.
6 months and five years, 6 months and one on the way.
Very
Lola
nice.
Lola is coming in June.
Lola, is that what
Lola.
You say?
Lola.
I like it.
Yeah, good tune.
I'm sure it's the right, you know, theme, but yeah.
Yeah, true. And they're all, like, they're local or? No, they're down in Florida,
one's
right?
Miami. One's right. Miami, one's here.
Right, okay.
So I'll be popping back, and I'll be doing a lot of, we're going down in June for the baby.
Nice.
And then we rented a catamaran for a week in the BVI.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so that's going to be cool.
Yeah, absolutely, that's cool. Very nice. Jeff Bosey's watching. Good morning, Jeff. Yeah, that's great stuff. And I want to get, you got some other really good news, which we'll get to in a minute. And we also got Tuesday trivia today, of course.
Can't wait.
All the stupid questions. I think that's why Hugh's not here. He's tired of feeling stupid.
That's it.
Because he gets them all wrong. Actually, last week, I think he got like 7 out of 10 or something. I was very impressed.
He probably has Google under his lap there.
Right. No, that's Andy Plagianos that does that. There's one story that I just read this morning. I want to know if you guys heard of it, because this might be one of the best stories I'll ever talk about on this show. The LA Philharmonic. Did you guys hear about their show over the weekend?
No.
So they're doing their concert, LA Philharmonic, Saturday night this was. And right in the middle of some Tchaikovsky movement, or whatever you call these things, the crowd, and it came multiple accounts, like a lot of people were,
tweeting
about where some woman apparently had a very loud orgasm in the middle of the show.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
A few people were trying to, you know, say no, she had a medical emergency, something, and other people were like, no, I was there. The guy next to her was smiling, and she didn't get up and leave. You know, it wasn't a medical thing. One person actually speculated that she may have fallen asleep and then had a bad dream and started screaming and then woke up. But again, you know, the guy with her was smiling, so I don't know, unless he's a prick and he's smiling and laughing at her for having a nightmare and screaming. But
nobody recorded this on cell phones.
And everywhere. Of course, when nobody. I heard this story, I did. I went looking around to see if I could find video, but I struck out, which is a story of my life when it comes to women orgasms. So I struck out. Right. Well, maybe he did.
Yeah.
But sure.
We'll never know.
Either way, whether he was involved in it or not, that girl's a keeper.
You know what it was? I guarantee it.
Yeah.
They got vibrating panties with a remote control.
Exactly.
I was just thinking. Yep.
This guy's probably sitting there playing with that remote control. Okay, here comes the crescendo.
Hallelujah. I either way, man. She's willing to do whatever, however it happened. She's willing to do it there. That girl's my hero.
Listen,
absolutely.
Just for wearing them, I'd marry her.
Yeah, absolutely right. Yeah. So I was like, I'm putting everything aside. That's one of the first things I'm bringing up this morning.
That's it.
Yeah, I thought that was awesome. Dana McAllister is watching. Hello, Dana McAllister. She says, hey. Hey, back. how you doing, all right?
I'm doing good, brother.
Yeah, we were talking the other day, because towards the end of the year, last year, you were coming in pretty regularly, like at least once a week for a couple of months there.
Yeah.
And we were talking about it the other day, and we realized that you had not been in here yet this year.
It just doesn't seem right. Where'd that time go, brother?
I'm always amazed how
fast it goes.
I thought
I was in here at the first of the year.
No.
And you insist I have not.
I really don't think you have been, and I'm floored by that. Time
becoming a thing. It was like becoming a thing.
It was becoming a thing, yeah. And nobody was putting an end to that thing.
Days off, change, work.
Yes.
That nasty four-letter word that gets in the way.
Working kids, they get in the way of everything.
Oh, my God. They take the life out of you.
They really do.
But it's worth every second.
I don't know. Every second?
Most seconds.
Yeah, most seconds. Right, we'll go with that. And you have a grandchild on the way. Your third grandchild.
Third, number three.
You must know time flies, right? When you're up to
little grandkids. Five already.
Wow.
I got a 5-year-old grandson. How's that humanly possible? Mm.
Right, yeah. Yeah. I'm floored. I mean, I'm always amazed. I have kids in their 20s and like grandkids?
Yeah.
Like I was just in my 20s.
Right, right. My son this year, he'll be 23. That's the age I was when I got married the first time.
Mm.
I'm like, I can't imagine him doing that. I was stupid for doing it. I was way too young. But, it's weird to me that the kids are that old. I'm always floored by that. Always.
I was 20-something when I got married. I'm still...
Yeah?
Still there.
Still with the same wife. Yeah. That's great. No, there is. That's great. How old were you when you got married?
About 27, 26. Oh, all right. Somewhere around here.
Yeah, all right. That's not bad. I was 23. I don't know. To me, that's that's a big difference at that age. No?
41, baby.
41.
You got to realize at 23, we were living together.
Oh, yeah?
So.
Yeah. Well, you were.
Drag it out.
But you were probably mentally, you were probably more mature than I was. You were in the service. You know.
I was a psychopath.
Well, there you go. I wasn't. I was a wimp.
I was a complete psychopath.
That's good.
How I'm not dead or in jail is... Completely amazing.
How you really consider yourself like? Give us the craziest thing you've ever done that you can talk about on the air.
We wrecked a bar fighting a biker gang in Smithtown.
In Smithtown, yeah, that Smithtown is known for the biker gangs. What the hell?
They walked in our little. We had the little. You know, we had the little hangout bar.
Yeah.
And he came in. They started drinking. They started picking up something. The next thing you know, it was. Chairs flying, like a movie. Chairs flying.
This is a Bronx Tale, drinking. Right?
Yeah.
No, you can't leave.
Can't leave.
It was basically that was it. I said something to this guy, and the guy goes, "I'm gonna walk up and punch you in the nose." I said, "Go ahead." He came up, he busted my fucking nose.
No kidding.
Yeah, he just smacked me down. Then I remember my future brother-in-law was there. He flips the guy over and slams him on a table.
Damn.
And the place went nuts.
Yeah.
That was just one thing.
The last time I got punched in the face, I thought I was going to cry. Mm. And I was like, I ran.
Yeah, I got, they broke it good.
Yeah?
Go ahead.
He did.
You ever been in a fight? I can't even picture that.
I'm usually trying to break them up.
Yeah, you're one of the nicest guys, man. I can't even picture you fighting with somebody.
I did take somebody three times the size of me down, though.
Did you?
Breaking one up.
Oh, breaking one up? Yeah.
Yeah.
You're like Joe Pesci, right?
I don't know what the hell I was thinking getting in the middle, because this guy was like, he's at least 6'2".
Oh, wow.
Very round, rotund in nature. And I don't know what the hell was going on. I was 20, I don't know, late 20s, early 30s. And I just went in the middle. I was like, dude, come on. Next thing I went like this. Wow. And he actually went and boom, I went on top of him.
You went on top of him and actually yeah. Like, holy shit, I took this guy down. Like,
The kids now don't do what just we did that? Do.
What's that?
The kids now don't do what we do.
No, they don't. No.
They're not even close.
No, not at all.
It's like, you know, they don't even have any idea how to have a good time.
Yeah, it's true. they don't know how to get into a good fight. It's true, though.
Yeah, they just bully each other on freaking social media.
Yeah, right.
They pick on each other. And
right. And that's the extent of it. Everything is social media.
Yeah.
You know, and even talking to another kid is just through a video game.
Yeah.
You know, it's weird to me.
You can't get lumps that way.
When my kids come, they're like, my daughter comes from Florida, and they come out.
Right.
When we were young, I had kids, and we all got the family together. Once the family was together, the grandparents took the kids, and we all went out. We're gone.
Nice.
Out.
Nice. Yeah.
Grandparents had to go. That's how it was. They come. They don't want. They want. They don't want to leave.
Right.
They don't go out anywhere.
Mm-hmm. They don't. They really don't. Which is, and you see it here. You know, the bulk of the crowds are, you know, I would say, 40s and up. I mean, there's some 20s, 30s, but it usually is an older crowd here.
Yeah, I don't know what they do. I mean, Smithtown was bought one bar from one end to the other, I remember.
Yeah.
And, you know, it went from Carmack all the way to Smithtown down to 111. Yeah. That whole strip was nothing but bars.
Yeah, sure.
You remember all the bars down in the South Shore and the Bordy Bonds? And
oh, yeah. OBI. Yeah. Yeah.
OBI, yeah.
Yeah, I still miss the OBI. I love that place. And
yeah, I had the Mad Hatter in Stony Brook, remember that place?
Oh yeah, I forgot about that one. Even here, right across the parking lot, Spit and Uncle Sam's and all that.
Yeah.
And I used to love going to Malibu down in Long Beach.
Oh yeah.
They were Malibu, yeah, but they had a whole stack of bars there in that little
thing
right there.
They had the rock club, they had the alternative club. Yeah. I used to love going to the alternative side because the girls were so weird. Like you just thought because they were weird, you had a better shot at getting some. Yeah.
I mean, we hated disco, but we had to go there because that's where the girls
were. Right, yeah.
Couldn't stand it. You had to get nicer clothes. And
right,
They'd watch you. You couldn't wear sneakers going in there.
Yep.
Oh, those are jeans. You can't wear jeans in here.
Yep. Fuck you. I know, yeah. That was me. I had buddies that always got mad at me. Like, you're wearing the jeans and the sneakers again? Yeah. Like, that's me, man. That's me.
We used to go out and we had to change and put nice clothes on. But that's where the girls were. You had no choice.
Right.
Yep.
Or if you were... Or if you're still too young, couldn't get into the club, that's when you just cruise the pike out here.
Oh, my God.
Well, right? When I was 18 when we were kids.
When you were,
when I was a kid, I was 18.
Right.
I remember going to bars with my football jacket from high school.
Right.
I remember my high school football jacket going to bars. And they didn't have pictures on the IDs. You had your ID, and we used to take razor blades and cut the letters out with a razor blade.
Right.
And then put another fake, like, you know, instead of now, it was 1957, we put 1956. Put, take a six, cut a six out, and paste it into the thing. And then you made your fake ID with your own license, no pictures on it.
Right. Where'd you grow up?
Smith. I was born in Brooklyn, moved out to Long Island, was about 15, 16.
Oh, okay.
And then I spent most of my decadent years in Smithtown.
Kicking bikers' asses. Yeah. Friender, cruise the pike, that's what they call it nowadays. No, that's what we called it back then, too.
Yeah.
It
was either the Pike or Deer Park Avenue was the other one.
Yeah, I never
Suffolk
did that.
Deer Park Avenue and the Pike.
And then in Queens they had...
The Bell.
Yeah.
Bell Boulevard.
Right. But I never did those. I always
cruise
just...
Them all, man.
Did you?
Yeah.
But you were... I'm just going to say it, and I think you know where I'm going here. You didn't have a problem with the ladies.
No, I was shy.
No?
No, I would cruise with Jen, right? I was a Jen. She was like my sister. She would like try and teach me how to pick up girls.
And
when I was
she
like
was
17, 18,
hot, man. She was hot. She still is hot.
I talk to them regularly. Oh,
I talk to them regularly.
Yeah.
but I'm just gonna say it, and I hope it doesn't upset you. But I mean, and I've told you this. I've had girls, and this is back when you know in our 20s. Mm. It was more than one talking about you know, that you're well endowed. And they were, you know.
I'm learning this now.
They're
it's all lies, I think.
Well, I remember actually.
I'm like a church mouse.
I remember going to you at the time, because I think it was after the second girl said it to me. I went to you, and I said, Jeff, do you know what this one told me? And I said to you, that's the second girl that told me this. And you said, because of your fingers, you were like, yeah, what I lack here, God made up for down there. That's what you said to me. You don't remember this?
I think the fifth.
Mary's
Let's
watching.
Bring the G word in.
I'm just joking around, because Mary, I'm just joking. we're going to play some Tuesday trivia soon. Bow chicka bow wow, says Carol Miner. All right, let's get to the exciting stuff so I don't forget. You have some something pretty exciting going on, don't you, pal?
I hope so.
I hope so, too.
We'll find out. It's Last Comic Standing in Mohegan Sun.
That's incredible. And I don't know anything about the process. So is this the first round? Is it last round?
It's the first round. You go up there and... You go to the first round, and if you get selected, you go to the second round, and then you go to finals in October.
Okay.
And
so it's only two rounds, and then you go to the final, right? Main show. Okay.
Right.
And did you submit for this, and they...
I actually don't remember doing it. I must have sent in a video to them.
Oh, okay.
And saw it and stuff like that. But they picked 90 comics for the whole set. The first round goes from now until July.
Okay.
And then the second round is August and September, and then the last round is...
And they go over the country, or is it just a few select places?
I don't know.
Yeah, I have no idea.
I don't remember how they did it. Right. I just know that they got a lot of applications.
Right. Yeah, I would think so.
And they emailed me and said, come up.
Wow. And what did they tell you, any rules, dress a certain way, or
they didn't say anything.
They tell you how much time you have.
Yeah, they're gonna do the first is 5 minute first round.
5 minutes, okay.
All right, and then 10 minute second round, and I think 20 minute third round, 15-20 minute third.
Really?
Yeah, I know the first round's five. I know the second one is like 10.
And you, yeah, I mean so you have that much material. Yeah, that's not a.
Yeah,
well, I'd be freaking
show
out.
In August with Mike, I did 35.
Right. Right.
And they only stopped because the show was over. We wanted to make an hour and a half show. We made an hour and a half show.
Right, right, right. Yeah, which is smart.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's why I stopped. So, okay, it's 9:30. It's time to go.
Yeah. All right, Fremder, I think you just wrote to the wrong person. He just wrote, hey, babe, how much time do I put the chicken on for?
Yeah. Wrong person.
Yeah, I think I'm a little nervous, though. He's confusing me for his wife. Oh, shit. Whoops, I was talking to Tex in the wrong app. Yeah, no shit.
He just sent his wife something about this guy's dick.
And she's writing back, oh, I didn't know you knew Jeff, too.
Invite him over for chicken.
They'll both be choking the chicken. Knew that was coming, right?
It was a cuckold, huh?
Yeah. So that's exciting. I guess they don't, it's not like a bringer where they people.
No.
But I wonder if they look at audience reaction. I wonder if it's smart to bring a ton of people and, cheer you on and shit.
I don't know how they're going to do it.
Yeah, I don't know.
But, I'm assuming it's going to be audience reaction.
Right, right.
But I've been in a few with audience reaction. Apparently, it didn't matter.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I'm assuming that.
And do you know do you have any idea how many people are at this particular show?
Yeah, they have a list. They sent me a schedule. I think there's 10.
Okay.
10 comics.
Oh, that's not bad.
No.
And did they have the names?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, anybody you know?
Well, Chris Williamson is going, not that day, but Chris Williamson's in. He's going to be on, I think I saw him on July.
Oh, I don't think I knew that. Oh, congratulations there, Chris. That's fantastic. Oh, wow. Oh, so they only. So it's only 10 comics at this one? Wow. That's wild. You got
somewhere around here.
That's
a lot of all the applicants. That's pretty
good. Yeah, I'm impressed, man. That's fantastic.
It should be fun. I know a couple. I know Keegan did it once. I know.
Yes.
Some other guys did it. So.
Now, and I will say, I love Williamson. He's a funny comedian and a great guy. But But I have no problem with whichever one of you gives me a higher price, you know, like to take one of you out.
I'm sorry?
I'm saying, you know, as much as I like Chris, like if your price is higher, I'll take him out for you so he can't get there.
There you go.
You'll Nancy Kerrigan him?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Well,
yes.
Well, if apparently they make the choice. I don't know when they make the choices or what they're doing. I'm just trying to. Here's the schedule. So here's their schedule.
Oh, my goodness. You can read that?
Yeah. Got to make it a little bigger, but.
That's what his wife said.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Well, they got 13 on that show.
Okay.
They got, looks like they got 12 on this show. So it's about 12. We're doing 5 or 60 minutes, plus they'll probably have some.
I should look at that list and try to get some of those people on here before the date, like, and we'll tell them how much they suck and stuff. And maybe, like,
there you go.
Yeah, we'll, like, talk them out of doing it.
Yeah, don't go. That's horrible. Yeah, it's horrible. Oh,
God, it's, oh, you'll never make that.
Yeah. You don't want to put yourself through that? Really?
Right. So, yeah, so that, and when, I'm sorry, this is when?
May 21st.
May 21st.
Mohegan Sun.
All right. You'll,
Sunday. It's a Sunday night.
So that following week, maybe that following Tuesday or something, if you want to come back in and tell us about the experience.
Yep.
All right, this, I believe, is DJ D-Love, I believe.
Oh.
Yeah. Hello?
Hello there, Carl. What's up there, Anthony? I mean, what's up, Tony?
What? Wow, what was that about?
How you doing, Tony? What's up, buddy?
How are you, pal? You everything good?
I'm doing bowling today. What's up with you?
You're bowling today. Are you a good bowler?
Yeah, I got my a 60 right now plus a spare.
You got a 60 plus a spare. All right. All right, well.
Yeah, how you been, Tone?
I'm doing all right. I'm doing all right. I expect you to hit at least 100.
So the concert is June 17th.
The concert is June 17th. So you're going to be at Jones Beach with KTU, and you're going to be on stage. Is that correct?
Yeah, I'm on stage.
What do you?
So I got a little rap song. Hold up. I'm going to bowl with you guys right now, too.
He's gonna throw his ball
right now, Tony.
All right,
yeah. Love bowling.
Stick those fingers in the holes and throw it down the gutter.
Woo! A 9.
A 9, very nice.
I was gonna say that didn't sound like a strike.
Got 9.
All right,
Tony.
All right, make sure you get that.
See you later, Tony. Have a
Okay.
Have a weekend, Tony. See you later.
All right, take care. All right, that was wow.
He's bowling. He's busy.
I guess so.
Be grateful we had time to call.
I am. Yeah. Always. Always am. Wow. All right. That was weird. I think that was the first time ever he was like, I got to go.
Yeah.
Like throwing a bowling ball down the alley. No, it wasn't like that. It was that. I don't know. All right.
Is he like trying to reference like throwing a hot dog down a hole?
I don't know what's going on. I never know what these people are talking about.
Exactly. We know what that's all about, and it's nothing to do with bowling.
Yeah, exactly.
It's called gutter humor.
Exactly. So, all right. So, other big news is that the writer strike has started in Hollywood.
Oh, really?
Yeah, today's the first day.
And nobody noticed.
Yep. Well, not yet. I don't know. I don't like it because the last time the writers went on strike, that's when all these bad reality shows came about. Because everything was supposedly unscripted. So, I don't know. To me, it just made TV, like, just kind of tank.
I mean, do you even watch regular TV anymore? Do you have any shows on there that you watch? Are there any more, Modern Families and Seinfelds and, you know, anything? I haven't seen one.
Okay, you got me thinking now.
Yeah.
I mean, my son is into all the superheroes and Star Wars, all those series. Yeah. So that's like the only stuff we watch. You got me. Yeah, I can't think of a series that. Yeah, I don't even know. I do find myself watching less and less.
Yeah, I haven't seen anything on there that I've been. I used to watch them. You know, these comedies.
Oh yeah.
See Seinfeld or see Cheers. Or.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, you got me thinking. I feel like I watched
30 years ago.
Yeah,
right.
I was gonna say I recently I streamed the first episode of Seinfeld, the pilot.
And it's not that good.
It was horrible.
Yeah,
dude.
Yeah.
It was absolutely horrible. I was like,
Dude, they were on the verge of cancellation.
Oh, yeah. Man.
It wasn't bad. I said when I had the thing, I sat there and streamed like
the whole thing?
The whole thing.
The progression of it.
Oh, of course, yeah. But that first episode was like rough. Yeah.
You know, I just finished. I just watched all the episodes of Soap.
Soap.
Oh God.
That wow.
Was the funniest fucking thing you.
Oh,
ever
I haven't thought
saw.
About that show in ages.
That was. You watch it again, you realize how funny it was.
So it still it holds up.
It does. None of the shit would be allowed to.
Right. Well, like Billy Crystal's
like
character.
You couldn't. Right. You couldn't do any of that
none,
stuff.
None
today.
Of the stuff was.
None.
Right.
Be on it today. It is the funniest freaking thing you ever saw.
I don't think I'll have to go back and watch that.
And meanwhile, like
that was unbelievably funny.
Archie Bunker was always the foil. Like he was the racist one, but he would always turn out to be the idiot in the end. Mm. So you would think it would get on these days, but you're right. They would never. Yeah. That shit would never fly. The Jeffersons. None of that shit would fly today. None of it. Yeah, and even Soap, because it wasn't Billy Crystal.
He was the
gay homosexual.
Was the shopping right. Gay. I mean, a lot of gay jokes.
Right, right.
Stuff like that. And then he dates the black girl, so then they have all that stuff going on. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
But it was it was funny.
Right.
I'm going to have to go back and stream it. I haven't seen
it. Yeah, I haven't seen that in ages. I was watching an interview this morning, Roy Wood Jr., comedian. He's on the Daily Show. He just did the White House correspondence dinner this past weekend.
Oh, God.
And he blasted, I mean, he, you know, like, he went after both sides, and he was even like, he roasted Biden sitting right there. He went to town on him.
What was it, the real Biden that was sitting there, or?
Well, true. I'm assuming it's the real one. You never know. I mean, now they're saying Michelle Obama's a man. Like, I can't.
They've been saying that for years.
I can't. But yeah, he went after everybody. He wasn't leaning either way, and of course I tried to cash in because Roy Wood Jr. was in here 2 years ago. So I then of course posted all the stuff. He had so much fun in here that he was in here before he went up, did the show, then came back. Yeah, he went after everybody. So I watched an interview with him this morning because of course there's some people coming down on him. Because he had a lot of jokes about the guy from CNN that just got fired, Lemon. Oh, Lemon. Really? Yeah. What's his Bob? No.
Don.
Oh, Bob Lemon was the Yankees.
Yes.
So of course they're coming down on him. But meanwhile, Roy Wood Jr. He's black. You know, Don Lemon is black, but you know, so is he. Like, he's like, you know, because they're coming down on, like, you know, we need that minority representation, that minority point of view on TV. You know, it's a bad thing that he got fired, which. I don't care what the argument is there. I don't care if that is right or wrong, but that's what they're saying to him. But he's sitting there in this interview, and he goes, I understand there's representation for everybody on TV, and everybody wants their person on TV with their point of view. But he goes, it was just a joke. And that, to me, you can't, as simple as that statement is, you can't explain it any better than that. Mm. It's a freaking joke. That's all it is. He has no power to get Don Lemon a job. He had nothing to do with man getting fired. He has nothing to do with any group. I mean, he even said, he goes, I'm a black guy. I understand we have a need, and I do feel it's important to have somebody representing us on TV. But it was just a joke. And that's, like you said, it was just funny. And everybody's offended. Everybody's got something to say.
Yeah, it's offended too easily.
Right.
Get a bunch of wussies.
And the news channels, is like, they don't report stories anymore. It's all about, this one tweeted that they're offended. This one got mad on Twitter about what somebody else tweeted. Mm. Like, that's news now, you know? Like, it does. It makes me nuts.
Elon took away the blue check marks.
Right, right. It's crazy to me. And I have, not next week, the week after, I have a murder mystery, a corporate event up in Connecticut. Now, I have my buddy, I'm sure you've heard me talk about Elio, my buddy in England, the musician. Him and his girlfriend's an actress and a singer. They're leaving tomorrow. They're both doing a cruise ship where he's performing his show and she's got a show that she's going to be performing. So the cruise ship, they're sailing to Brazil, and then when they dock in Brazil, that's when they finish. So the cruise line is flying them to New York. Then, like, New York is their stopover before they go to England. Mm. So Elio asked the cruise line, he said, do you mind if we stay one day in New York then fly home. And they're like, yeah, no problem. So he was like, you know, so he contacted me and a few other people. You know, I want to be able to get to see you. I'm going to spend the day in New York. Oh, great. But that day is the day of my show in Connecticut. So I said to Amy's girlfriend, I said, look, you know, I need a female role that hasn't been filled. I said, why don't you do the show? So she agreed to do it. So I'm all excited, you know, to work with her. She's a close friend, so I'm very excited to do a show with her. But just I know this is a long story, but where I'm going with this is yesterday I was on the phone with them. She had some questions about the script. And I'm describing to her how the show works. And Bosey is in this murder mystery. He's been doing the murder mysteries with us. And he plays my daughter. He, you know, he comes out in a dress and makeup, and the audience, you know, that visual always works. Mm. So I'm telling him that by the way, the you know, my daughter is played by a man, and Elio and Amy, both of them, their faces just, like, the look on their faces totally changed, like, not in a good way. So I said, hang on, I said, relax, I said, this isn't a drag show, but you can see they're trying to, like, get a grasp on what we're doing. So I said, think Milton Berle, like Milton Berle in the old days of television. It was funny. It wasn't a drag thing. It wasn't a statement of any kind. It wasn't trans. It was just funny.
No agenda to it.
But they're England. They don't even really know. They know the name, but they don't really know who that is. So I'm like, oh, shit. So I was trying to explain it to them, and I don't think I did a good job. Like, I think they're really thinking now that this is like some kind of, like, I'm trying to make a statement, or it's going to be some kind of trans thing. Yeah. I'm like, no. And they said at one point, so it's a farce. I was like, yes, let's go with that. And we just kind of left it there. Like, I didn't know how else to describe it. And it's I don't know, it's just so weird now, you know.
It's a comedy show, basically.
Right.
That's, you know.
Right. The visual of the guy, you know, obviously not meant to look pretty.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, that visual always works. I've had girls play the part in the past, and they don't get as many laughs as the guy does.
Right.
It's that simple.
Because it's funny. And that cracks me up, because you always see these memes and posters. Oh, look. Everybody used to accept drag queens and stuff like that, and pointing at the Milton Burrows and the Tootsies. And no, they were laughing at them.
Right.
They were making fun of them. It was a ridiculous concept.
Right.
That just is funny.
So that's what I should have said to them, Tootsie. I should have done that.
So if you think that you're trying to say, oh, it's accepted because it was always accepted. No, we laughed at you.
Right. Right.
It was people were making fun of you.
Yeah.
So don't use that as your justification,
right?
Of acceptance. Mm-hmm. It's silly,
right? Right.
It's the wrong. He went the wrong way.
But
he went the wrong way.
It is making fun, but at the same time, it was like, it wasn't like a bullying situation.
No,
it was in fun, right? Right. I mean, that's why movies like Tootsie worked. It was a smash hit
because
it was all fun.
Yeah.
And now you can't.
You know, it was funny.
You can't do that anymore.
It wasn't this. It wasn't accepted. It was funny.
Right.
It's a completely different.
Right. Right. And
thing.
Dustin Hoffman.
They don't go have fun. I went to drag shows. Miami has this great club down there. We went there a bunch of times.
Mm-hmm.
Great drag shows. They used to have the Changs, whatever that was.
The what?
P.F. Changs.
P.F. Changs.
Oh, P.F. Changs. Yeah. Yeah, I remember that.
We went there a bunch of times.
They had drag shows there?
Yeah. It was all drag. It was great. We had great time. You know?
They have them here sometimes.
So that's, but it's not.
Yeah.
But the point they were trying to make, they didn't make.
Yeah.
So they're gonna do it still.
They're still doing it. Yeah. Yeah, but they had to go. We didn't finish the conversation, so we're talking more today, and I'm sure it's gonna come up again. Mm-hmm. And I'll definitely throw Tootsie out there and see how that works out. When I sit down in front of the TV, says Frender, and I stream, I usually need some napkins. Carol Miner says, soap was hilarious. Frender, I walk like George Jefferson when I have to shit. What? That was a joke. Why did he walk like that? Because he was farting so much, and he was, like, you know, blowing it away. You never know. Michelle Obama might just have those missile-launching codes right between her legs. Oh, my goodness. Carol Miner, yeah, Shakespeare had men playing women, the women roles, and vice versa. Mm. Yeah, right. One time I thought I walked in the P.F. Chang's, but it was really a Pokemon convention. I don't get that. Maybe he made that face when you told him because he was embarrassed of the red thong he really had on underneath all that. Right. Okay. Yeah. So that...
Well, that'd be cool. They're going
to
do that.
I'm excited about it. Yeah, that I actually get to work with her. Yeah, that'll be fun because she's...
And then they're jumping on a cruise ship here?
No.
Getting on the cruise ship?
Oh. They're going on the cruise ship, I believe it's tomorrow.
From the UK.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sailing to Brazil.
Wow.
And then they're done. And then, so from Brazil, they're flying. And I don't know.
They're flying up.
You would know. I don't know why they're not flying straight to England from Brazil.
Yeah.
But or why the stopover wouldn't be like Florida or something. But for some reason, the stopover, they're flying them to New York. The original plan was flying them to New York. And I think it was like they were getting to New York early and then later that day flying to England. Something like that. And then Elio said.
A lot of South American flights get into New York like, you know, 6, 7 in the morning.
Okay.
And then the London flights don't really start kicking out. I mean, you get like maybe two Londons that'll leave in the morning between 8 and 10. And then, you know, Heathrow is shut down as curfew. Because when they get there, it's now basically 12 hours later.
Right,
so
right.
So they, you know, they'll leave at probably 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 at night.
Okay. So
flights all that time.
Right. And he didn't want to do that. You know, so he's like, well, you know, let's just stay for
stay
a day.
Over, yeah.
So
find out who he's flying when he goes back to
England?
England.
Okay. I'll ask.
Oh, coming up from South America. I'm flying out.
I do know he is. I'm almost positive they're coming to JFK.
Mm-hmm. If they're coming from Brazil to South America to New York, they're coming to JFK.
Oh, what? Oh, that's an automatic thing? Like they wouldn't
JFK.
Go?
Yeah, LaGuardia.
That's the international
stuff.
Yeah. Oh, right. Okay. So, yeah. So I know that much. But you want to know the actual airline?
Yeah. Okay. Maybe I'll give him a little special greeting.
Hey, you know, hey.
Well, not like that. Yeah. He doesn't get to see how... No, I mean...
yeah, right. I pick him up that day. Your friend, he's hung.
Bloody hell. yeah, find out. Let me know.
Okay, I will.
Then I just go to the gate and yell at him for never texting me back when I was in England. That's okay.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that. Yeah, that's really funny. I forgot all about that. All right, what else do I got here? So we're going to do Tuesday Trivia soon. Hugh Murray is not here today. He's embarrassed at how bad he does in trivia. Let's see. Did you hear... So talking about Elio and music and stuff, I was reading something with Elton John. He's, you know, he's doing his farewell tour. You know, he's not going to tour anymore, and he's on his final tour saying goodbye. So he said he's excited to put certain tunes behind him, like to never have to sing them again. And he said the last time I have to sing Crocodile Rock, I will probably throw a party. It was written as kind of a joke, like a pastiche. It became a big hit. The people love to sing along, so I have to play it because I love to entertain people. But I have to say, when the last show is done at the end of the tour, I'll never sing that song again. I don't know. That kind of bothered me. That sounded a little ungrateful. Like, you're Elton John. You've had massive, massive success.
Give the money back you made.
Exactly. Yeah, right. That's kind of like what I'm thinking.
Give the money back.
I mean, and I do get it. And I don't know if... I know you write often, you know, so I don't... Do you ever feel like, oh, I'm sick of telling this joke? Like, I got to change it up?
No. I mean, you change stuff, but...
Right. You change stuff just to keep it fresh, just so you're not doing the same thing over and over in case, you know, certain people are seeing you again, but certain things you have to do, like I always think, you know, of like the headliners. You know, these guys became headliners because certain jokes really resonated with people, and they're coming. These people that are then coming because they want to hear that particular joke.
It's like a singer,
right? You got to do certain hits you just can't avoid.
Right, you got to do some of the old stuff.
And I understand you maybe because you're doing it night after night. But still, but to get to that level and be like, I'm throwing a party, so I never get to sing that song again. Like you said, you know, give the money back then. Right. That song alone, he probably made a few million, you know? Like I mentioned here a few weeks ago, I forget what he calls himself now. P. Diddy? Or is he just Diddy now?
I don't even
know what he is.
Diddy, Dickhead, whatever.
Yeah, exactly. So Dickie, he's saying that because he sampled Every Breath You Take on that song he did some years back. He was, whatever interview he was doing, he mentioned that he has to pay Sting $5,000 a day. for royalties from that song. And I mean that. So that alone, that's like a million change a year, right, just on the one song. Mm.
Well, how much is he making off of that song? That's
well, right.
Yeah, if he's able to give him $5,000
right,
a day.
Right, well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm talking about Sting's end. Yeah, that's a million and change a year just for Sting on that one song. Mm-hmm. I would be thrilled to have that one song. I would throw it in every commercial, you know, every movie, whoever wanted it, you know. Yeah. And to be able to make at least a million a year on one stupid song, like, I would be thrilled, you know. And I see guys like that. I don't like when celebrities get so big they're out of touch. I don't like that.
You know, if you were smart, you would have taken $5,000, hired somebody to write his own stuff.
Right.
He wouldn't have this problem.
I'm sure just not singing certain tunes aren't the only thing that's behind him. Right.
Speaking of farewell tours, you know, Aerosmith just announced a farewell tour.
I did see that, yeah.
This guy's 90 years old. How many tours he got left?
I'm going to have to go if I can. I've never seen him.
You've never seen Aerosmith?
I've never seen him in concert, no.
I saw them
you'll
once.
You'll be disappointed. I saw Sinatra in his last concert. Mm.
Yeah.
Oh, what a disaster that was.
Oh, yeah.
Really, huh?
God. I saw him in Westbury.
Yeah. Right. My buddy used to
run. When I tell you, the teleprompter was bigger than that TV screen.
Yeah. No
and
kidding.
The words were like this big.
Oh, wow.
And he kept, in the middle of the song, he said, okay, stop. Go back. In the middle of a song.
Oh, jeez.
He had to go back to the words. They wheeled him out like a dolly because he was all braced up.
Really?
He stood still like a statue. And then he went through these songs. Like I said, you could see the teleprompters all over. Yeah, things right. Turned around. The words were this friggin' big.
Jeez.
Right?
That's sad,
and then
huh?
He would stop and go rewind it. did the thing. He did a couple of... It wasn't on that long.
Right.
These guys came whisking out. They whisked him away. And then you had to stay in your seat. You couldn't get out of your seat until he left.
Oh, left the building or just left the
gone.
Room?
In the limo. When the limo got out, then they let you out. They had the doors blocked. You couldn't get out of the
Holy
back.
Cow.
Yeah.
It is sad. I think it was my brother. He saw Chuck Berry, like, close to the end. And, like, he couldn't even sing. He had some girl up there singing the songs, you know, while he played. Hmm. You know, it's tough when these guys get old. Yeah. But I've seen Steven Tyler on TV and stuff. It seems like he can still sing.
Yeah.
I don't know about the rest of the guys. They look like they're half dead, but. But even like Isaac McCartney, man, I mean, his voice is gone.
Mm.
Gone. It's a shame. Which reminds me, because you're a big music guy like me, they got all this AI technology, artificial intelligence.
Yeah.
Like, you see this stuff on YouTube? Like, people are like recreating, or they're creating new songs. Like, hear John and Paul sing this, and like, well, and it sounds just like them. It's crazy.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
I was gonna say, because Paul did a thing on his last show where he had...
he had the thing with Lennon.
With John, yeah, which was
no.
Cool. I mean, it's not AI, obviously, but...
I'll see if I can find an example. It's really kind of freaky.
What do you think about people, it, though? How many imitators are there that sound just like the guys?
Well, true, yeah.
AI, you know?
Yeah.
You go to some of these cover bands,
mm-hmm.
They sound just like them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's how they found the guy to replace Steve Perry and Journey.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
They had a Long Island Journey band. That guy sounded just like him.
Yeah. Yes.
I heard that, yeah.
Yeah, he also dabbles in comedy, that guy. Bill something. So here's the song God Only Knows by the Beach Boys, sung by Paul McCartney. And this is all fake, but it sounds just like him. It's not exact, but if someone said to me, who's singing that, I would say that sounds like McCartney.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's a whole bunch of shit like that on YouTube where they have this weird AI technology in there. Yeah. To me, that's just, like the sky's the limit. Like it, and I'm not saying this is a good thing. I'm saying it's like...
I don't think all this AI stuff...
It kind of sucks, right? I mean, it's killing originality, you know what I mean? It's weird, but yeah, Aerosmith, the Black Crowes are opening up.
Yeah.
Which those guys are fantastic. Yep. Yeah, that's a great band. I've seen them as well. Carolina, saw Aerosmith in Vegas 4 years ago. They were great. Fremder, saw Aerosmith when I worked for WBAB, and I swear, being that close to Steven Tyler, he could fit about 100 microphones in that mouth. It's a mystery to me how Liv Tyler came from that. I met Liv Tyler once.
Oh, yeah.
She was one of those where people are actually stopping. She's twice as beautiful as she is in the movies. Mm. In real life, it's stunning. And yeah, everybody was just like stopping to watch her walk by. It was crazy. Yeah. Yeah, and Vicky says too. Yeah, all right. Like in concerts, they're using holograms. Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of weird.
Yo, they're going to need this AI because there's no more Jimmy Page. There's no more Ginger Baker. There's no more.
Yeah. Right.
Right. Yep. No Eric Clapton. Nope. Who's playing this stuff?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's, and, you know, I sometimes go back and forth. Am I sounding like an old man or not? But like music from, say, like the 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, and maybe some of the 80s too, like these songs just, they're not going away. But the past 20 years, a song is a hit. You hear it on the radio for, you know, a few months, and that's it. Mm. Like the song is totally forgotten.
There's
about
no music in it.
Right, that's what I mean. So I don't. But the kids of the teenagers, the 20-year-olds, I don't. Do they see? Do they feel the same way, or do these songs stick with them? So that 20 years from now, they'll be like, oh yeah, they're still playing those songs. You know, I don't know.
Yeah, who knows?
But I go back and forth on that kind of stuff. Fremda, that sounded like AI to me. Yeah, that's why I said it's AI and it's not really Paul McCartney. Keep up. Or are you talking about me? One of us sound like AI. I don't know. I never know what Fremder's talking about. There he is. Yo! So, Fremder, online there's interviews with Elon Musk saying how companies should quit AI manufacturing because if they don't, it will take over the world in a terrible way.
Yeah, absolutely. That's 100%.
Yeah, I just heard something the other day where like some of these AI robots, like they're programming them to actually have feelings and the ability to learn. That was the part that scared me. The ability to learn, like then what evil shit are they going to do? Like, you know, it's going to turn into like Terminator shit where they're destroying like blowing buildings up and shit. I don't know, man. Robots that can build robots and teach themselves based on trial and error. Yeah, so nobody's going to get laid. Or maybe they get laid more because we won't have jobs anymore. We'll be sitting at home while the robots are doing everything.
I'll be dead, old man.
Well, then you better start teaching Lola how to work an AI.
Unless they come up with a way to keep me going.
There you go. Oh, see that?
Then I'm all for it.
Keep you going, but that might not be a good thing. You know, as we get older, there'll be aches and pains and shit. So not only keep us going, right?
Yeah,
so not only keep us going, but to like keep us at our peak age or something.
That's it.
What age would you want to stay at?
35.
35? Why? Because you were fighting, or
I was in my best shape.
Yeah.
Between 26 and 35, and I was still playing. I was, you know, still playing ball, still doing.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You know.
All right. What about you?
Yeah,
what age?
I was going to say about 30, 35.
35?
Yeah.
All right.
20 is too, you're too stupid.
Yeah, you're stupid.
Oh, that's interesting then. I wonder if you could pick physically what age you want to be, but then a different age mentally. That would be kind of cool.
Yeah. I would keep this brain in that body.
Right. Yeah, that's exactly where I'm going with that. Yeah. I think, I'd probably the brain around right around this age, but yeah, I had my leg issues at 32, so I'm going to say 30 was probably. Although I was pretty fat at 30, so I might go like physically like 25.
Probably but had more hair at 32.
I had bad hair. I mean, you know, I had like Brillo pad or what they call the Jufro. Yeah. Like my hair grew out and it looked like a Brillo pad. It didn't. Like Chuck's got good head of hair.
That's all you got left.
That's it.
That's it.
Oh, and then fuck the AI. Get rid of me then if nothing else, if that's all you got. But you got your eyes.
That's it. I got my eye. I can see and I can comb my hair.
If I could bang a robot, I would bang the maid in the Jetsons because at least I know she's getting two things done at once. Yeah, that was on one of our other shows. What was that, last week, the week before? Treading Water with you, Hugh Murray and Travis Grant. They were talking about AI and Travis turns to Hugh and he goes, would you bang a robot? Without missing a beat, Hugh goes, oh, 100%. I was cracking up. Fremder wants to know, is it Jufro downstairs also? Why would you want to know that? Why would you want to know that?
Everybody's got a Jufro down there.
Well, yeah, exactly.
True. Or nothing.
Or it's bald.
Or it's, yeah. Depends on your manscaping.
Do you shave it bald?
No.
I was going to say. Well, that.
You got to keep it neat.
Keep it neat, I understand. But, do you use a razor?
Hey, whatever. You can use a little manscaping. Commercials. You got the manscaping buzzers.
Yeah, but but that's why I'm asking. Like, the buzzers or razor, like any of that shit. I'm scared to...
Just sit in a bucket of nail. You'll be fine.
But, there you go.
That's it. Not to worry about
that. That might not feel too good.
Well.
Curly fries hanging from your balls.
There you go.
So you returned with the eyes, and then you even returned to the stage. You played the brokerage last week.
Yeah.
Did you hear that? Somebody knocking?
I think it might have been down the hall.
Oh, okay. You played the brokerage last week?
I was at the brokerage last week.
Last Thursday, right?
But that's basically it. Because I was down and out for... I was in Florida, and I had a thing, so I was out for like 2 months.
Right, so this that's where I'm at.
Really the first time.
Yeah, the first one, yeah. So it felt good?
It was great.
Yeah. Did you use any of that time to write, or?
You always write.
Yeah,
you know, the problem is you got to get up a lot to stick it in there.
Right,
you just want to do your regular thing and stick one,
right,
one in there and see how it goes.
Right, yep.
You know, you want to get up there with the whole list of new shit and
right,
be stuck.
Yeah,
I did that a few weeks ago when we were talking before we went on the air. That you know, you were nice enough to ask me about getting up there a little bit, and I've barely changed my set in the past 3 years because I don't go up regularly like you guys. So I don't feel ready to make too many changes. I'm still trying to get the stuff out. But when I was here last, I was hosting and I'm doing my set in the beginning and I was like, screw it. I got one thing that I was thinking about. I'm going to throw it out here. And it totally sank.
It happens.
Right.
You throw something out there.
Right. But then I got the laugh because then I even said, all right, well, guys, that was a new one. I said, I know now that I'm just going
to
take it out.
I try to throw one little thing in.
Yeah.
And then see if it hurts, and if it hits, right. Keep it. If not, you
know. Right. 2 weeks ago, I was, you know Brandon Lacaruba? I'm with you. Brandon comes in with me here on Thursdays. He hosts a broken, what he calls a broken mic. It's an open mic, but he has other comedians come in.
I heard about that. I haven't been there yet.
So he had me as one of the panelists 2 weeks ago. And I felt weird about it. Like, I'm, you know, judging these, you know, but it was fine. And we ended, it was nice. It would turn into like a nice constructive conversation between the other panelists and even some of the audience members and the comedians, you know, just talking about crafting and whatnot. But he started, which I didn't know he was going to do, he started throwing the panelists up to do a set. And so I wasn't really mentally prepared. I didn't know I was going up. So he sent Rob White up first. And Rob White was the same way. He's like, I didn't know we were going up. And he was only giving the panelists 3 minutes. So Rob was like, Rob owns the tattoo shop out east.
Yeah, yeah.
I forget what it's called. Forgive
Rob's
me, Rob.
Rob's tattoo shop.
What's it?
Rob's tattoo shop.
It's like the Lucky Duck or something. Something duck is in there somewhere. So he gets up first, and he said, you know what? He goes, I only have 3 minutes. I didn't expect to go up. He goes, I'm just going to do stuff about tattooing. He goes, I don't normally do that, you know, because that's my, you know, my real job. He goes, I don't really mix the two, but I'm going to just talk about a bunch of tattoo stories. So he told a few, and he was talking about, and he was doing a lot about people who, like, do tattoos that, like, have something to do with death. So he goes up, and then they throw me up, and I'm like, all right, screw it. You know, again, 3 minutes, wasn't prepared, and I'll follow his lead talking about death. And I just go, anybody fall in a grave lately? And I got a laugh, because when I was 19, I fell in my grandmother's grave. So I told that story. I was like, screw it. I only got 3 minutes. I'm not going to sit here and try to figure out which one of my bits I'm going to do. I'm just going to tell the story about falling in my grandmother's grave. But I got some laughs as I was telling the story. Like, you know, I was, you know, because when I went down so fast and hit the ground so hard that everything just flew out of my pockets. So I didn't come right back up because I couldn't find, I think it was my keys. My keys ended up buried in dirt. I'm digging around looking for my keys. So, bits and pieces of the story was getting laughs. So as I'm up there telling the story, I'm like, son of a bitch, I got to work this into a bit now. So I thought that was kind of cool how I just, like a spur of the moment unplanned thing could now be a possible bit. So that's my whole story.
How did you fall in?
the I never told you this. We've been friends for like 40 something years.
That's
right.
So, I mean, because usually the coffin is over the hole on the whole mechanism that lowers it in.
Exactly. That's exactly right. So the she was buried here in Westbury. Now, you know, we grew up in Hicksville. And I lived with my grandmother for, at that point, most of my life. She died when I was 19. I lived with her until I was 12. So, she and my grandfather, her husband, died years prior. So she used to drag me to the cemetery, and I used to, you know, see the headstone, and we'd visit Grandpa. So at her funeral, one of my cousins who doesn't live nearby, you had the like you said, the casket was there over the hole. We were the whole family's on one side of the casket. The other side of the casket was the mound of dirt. Mm. And there was a tarp over the dirt.
Usually the green.
Yes. But the green tarp, it comes down, and it actually was covering the hole as well, where the over the casket. So a cousin says to me that he couldn't see the headstone. He wanted to see our grandfather's name. So I said, I've been here a million times. If you walk to the other side of it, you can see his name. So I go in between the casket and the mound of dirt onto the green, thinking that there was like maybe a foot of ground in between the casket and the dirt, and there wasn't. So as soon as I stepped on the green, boom, I went right down.
Pretty much landing like on top of your grandfather.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Grandpa saved my life. Yeah. They did tell me after the fact because, and I didn't see the coffin. A lot of people are like, oh, my God, did you see the coffin? Did you see him? No. There's actually like a metal frame down there that the coffin sit in, and there's a piece of plywood in between, like if you're getting buried on top.
Yeah.
There's a plywood in between, so I didn't. I just saw plywood. But so they told me after the fact that if he wasn't already dead and buried, I would have fell 18 feet. But because he's already there, and I don't, the math doesn't make sense. This is what they told me. But because he was there, I only fell 6 feet. So like the ground was literally right here, and so I hit the ground. There's that moment of shock. Like I'm telling you, it was just so fast. It was like a blink of an eye. Yeah. It just like there was a few seconds of, where did everybody go? Where am I? Like really? And then I realized okay, everything fell out of my pockets from the impact. Then it registers. I hear my mother screaming. She's envisioning me like falling down like a bottomless pit or something. So again, the ground was right here. So it wasn't like I was in any danger. I could have pulled myself right back up. But I just went. I just started waving my hand. I'm okay. I just have to find my stuff. And then I did. I had to look around. My wallet I found quickly, but my car keys was buried under dirt. It took me a minute. I'm like sweeping the plywood from the of dirt so I could find my keys. But it was the great thing. It was the best thing ever because we left this funeral laughing our asses off. Like the hearse drivers, the limo drivers, they were like. Like they were actually looking at us. Like, now I'm sure they never saw anybody leaving a funeral laughing so hard. Oh, and then we went back to the house after, and that's all we were all talking about and having. We just had a blast from that.
How many nightmares are you responsible for? For people seeing a hand rising out of a grave.
See, they should have been
waving. Yeah.
Just picture that. There comes a hand rising out of the grave.
I have a feeling I'm responsible for nightmares for other reasons, possible. So.
They should have been cell phones.
I have a feeling one, too, that when my mother in law went down there and they had the wrong body in the casket.
I think you may have told me this once, but. So you went to identify the body, right?
No, we went down for the funeral.
It was the actual
down
funeral.
There, they had the name up there, they got the flowers, they got the pictures of her all over the frigging place. We walk up there and,
it's
got the wrong stiff in the
box. It's a 300-pound bald man.
Yeah, it's like this, So I called, I remember calling, I went, wow, you got the wrong body here. Oh, they look different when they pass.
Yeah. That's
no,
what
it,
that's,
it ain't her.
Right? I said, hey, pal, listen, this one's about 100 pounds less and doesn't have a mustache. Yeah.
But he actually tried that at first, insist it was her?
It was the wrong one. It was the wrong one.
Oh, my goodness. So what finally convinced him? Like, you just kept insisting that it's not her?
It's not her. I mean, pal, come on. My sister-in-law's crying. Hey, she can't be lying around here somewhere. Come on.
So what, you guys actually...
I made a whole thing on it.
Yeah. And then...
That story.
And then, so once he realized, how fast were they able to change it out?
They changed it, but the room didn't notice.
He didn't fucking notice.
Yeah, so the body that it was, what, that person's family was in the other room?
Yeah, they had the body. They put the signs on the wrong.
Oh, okay, wall. Okay. So right. She was just in the other room.
She was in the other room, right. And this one was in here. But they have pictures,
right,
of the proper people.
Right,
everything was right except the bodies.
Right, and that family didn't even notice.
Nobody said anything. I didn't hear anybody say anything.
So funny.
They show how close they were with their loved ones.
I didn't say
yeah, exactly.
Like I say, no one noticed Grandma gained 100 pounds and grew a mustache.
That's great.
But that was, so I did a thing on that. And actually, yeah. Believe it or not, that took a little, I had to do it a few times and twist it and turn it and
sure.
It and,
yeah. Like, I'm actually considering that being my opening line when I walk out there. Anybody fall in the grave lately? Yeah. Like, I don't know. Like, it's such a weird way to start that it might actually work. I don't know. The Black Duck. Thank you, Andy Plajanos. The Black Duck. And where's that? In Selden, I believe? And Rob White does great work, so you gotta... He's gotta check his eyes.
That's it. You're old, you gotta go.
Alright, so when Chuck gets back, we will start Tuesday Trivia. Tuesday Trivia coming at you.
I sucked at the last one, I think, didn't I?
Probably.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have high expectations for you.
No, I don't either. I wouldn't. You know me long enough, so you know.
It's that Hicksville education, man. I talk about it all the time on here, that Hicksville education. But there are some people that are, like, smart that are from Hicksville, which I don't understand. Like, Vicky, she's watching. Carol Miner does very well in Tuesday Trivia. You know, I don't, like, we all went to the same schools. How did that happen? I don't get it.
They paid attention.
Maybe, but I'm telling you, man, we had some weird teachers.
Mm.
You know, I...
Yeah.
Mr. Razak never taught an ounce of science, and he was.
We had like old hippie teachers too.
Some were hippie teachers, yeah.
We had some. Think about it; they were there in the '60s.
Oh, back then, yeah.
You know,
a ton of these teachers I had were teachers my mother had, and she graduated in '62.
Mm.
And Mr. Irwin was a math teacher. He used to.
Oh my God!
You remember him?
Yeah.
He was like 6 foot something. Like, probably close to 500 pounds. And he used to lay on the floor and go to sleep in the middle of class.
Oh, really?
Oh, that guy.
I've never seen him do that.
That guy was, he was nuts.
Oh, my God.
Carol Miner, Boughton was a hippie but a great teacher. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Fremder, luckily my hot health teacher grade on a curve. All right. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, it is that time. It's Tuesday. We're going to do a little Tuesday trivia. The way this works, I'm going to ask some random trivia questions. There's no theme. There's no nothing. Just random trivia questions. You guys, please put your answers in the comment thread. And Chuck and Jeff are going to try and answer these questions as well. And then I do not give the answers until I'm done asking the questions. We go back to the beginning, ask the questions again. We read your answers, go over their answers, and then give out the correct answers. There's no prizes. There's no nothing. This is just a way to make fun of all you guys with your bad answers. All right. With that, question number one, just for you, pal. It's a hard one, though. It's a hard music question. Name the band Ringo Starr left to join the Beatles.
Roy Storm and Hurricanes.
Jesus.
We're geeks there, Chuck.
That was...
You want to just agree with
left,
it?
He left to go to the Beatles.
Yes, the band he left. It was not a famous band.
Well, he's correct. I know that.
Right. Oh, okay. Did you? You know that?
No.
What is the capital of Connecticut?
It's Hartford, isn't it?
Well, I'll tell you later.
It's either Hartford or New Haven, so we only got two cities.
No, it's Milford.
that's your guess, Milford?
No.
Oh.
Oh, no. Greenwich.
Greenwich.
It's Hartford.
It's probably Hartford, but I just want to disagree.
Next question. Johnny Cash recorded a number of live albums at what in... Excuse me, I'll start that again. Johnny Cash recorded a number of live albums at what unusual institutions?
Folsom Prison.
He's absolutely correct. I'm not arguing with that one.
Yeah. All right.
Correctamundo.
I mean, he can answer first and I can agree.
you guys are like back and forth here.
That works.
This one's easy, at least in my opinion it's easy. In the live-action film Popeye, who played Popeye?
Robin Williams.
Yes.
Okay. The Same-Sex Marriage Act was signed into law by which New York governor?
The Same-Sex Marriage Act was signed into law by which New York governor?
Who's the one for Pataki?
Before, you think? Before Pataki?
It's just been around for a while.
It couldn't have been Cuomo Sr. or Kerry.
It had to be Cuomo Sr.
Think Sr.?
Yeah,
Cuomo Sr.? Yeah. You're agreeing with him?
Well, definitely was it Hugh Carey, and if it was before Junior, then it's got to be Senior.
Yes.
Because it wasn't Pataki.
Right.
Okay. I met Carey once. He was smashed out of his mind.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. It's my whole story. Who was the winningest active Major League Baseball manager before he retired in 1996? The winningest active Major League Baseball manager.
Buck Showalter? Was that?
No, he's working. Was it Torrey?
Is Torrey still? Is he retired?
He's retired from managing.
Yeah.
Buck Showalter's managing the Mets.
Yeah, retired in '96, never came back. He's since passed.
Oh.
Oh no! So it can't be Torrey.
Oh, right. Torrey, then.
You're welcome for that little.
Yes, thank you.
Well, sort of, but the Dodgers sucked. Who the hell is it?
I really thought you'd know this.
I should know it. I probably do. And you guess, oh yeah, that's right. It's one of those things.
I'm gonna have to pass on this one.
Oh, all right.
I just saw Tommy Lasorda out there and just
see if it sticks.
Yeah, why not? Another baseball question for you. Name the only player, well, only major league player, to play at least 500 games with each of four different teams. And if you want, I'll even give you the teams. Houston, Montreal, the Mets, and Detroit. Played 500 games with each of those teams.
Houston and the Mets.
Houston, Montreal, Mets, and Detroit.
Rusty Staub.
Yeah, that's, well, yeah, we did, you know, Rusty Staub, didn't you? He had to. The only other one, Houston and the Mets, is Ryan, but I don't think Ryan played for Detroit.
No,
I think
so.
Nolan Ryan.
I don't think he played for Detroit. Rusty Staub's a good one.
Mm.
I'll go with Rusty Staub.
All right.
I don't think Ryan played for them.
Name the first woman to produce a sitcom.
What's her face? Laverne and Shirley.
Oh, Marshall? Yeah, Penny Marshall?
Penny Marshall.
You going to agree with that one,
yeah,
Jeff?
I agree.
All right.
She's got that whole Marshall bloodline.
This is like bonding, how you guys are like agreeing with each other. Yeah. It's beautiful. It's very beautiful.
We're cheating.
All right. Next question. What is a kerfuffle? A kerfuffle. What is a kerfuffle?
A screw-up. It's a screw-up, a mistake, an error.
Screw-up or mistake.
Is it kerfuffle or is it?
Kerfuffle.
Oh, and the other one is conundrum. Yes. Yes. Conundrum. Yes. He's correct.
Kerfuffle is a screw up.
You're agreeing? No, look at this.
Because I know the conundrum and the kerfuffle is.
All right. Last question. True or false? Sex during a woman's period is harmful. True or false?
False.
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 It's messy, but it's not.
Yeah, kind of disgusting. Yeah. All right. Nice job, fellas. Nice job. All right, we're going to go and to the beginning of the comments, of where your answers are. Let's see. Okay. Name the band Ringo Starr left to join the Beatles. Jeff said Rory Storm and the Hurricanes. Chuck agreed. Fremder says the Muppet Band. Carol Miner says the Hurricanes. Yeah, that is correct. Rory Storm and the Hurricanes. Rory Storm went on to commit suicide.
He gets the gold star for that one.
He does. What is the capital of Connecticut? Chuck said Hartford. Jeff said Greenwich. From the said capital. Vicky said Hartford. Okay, that's it. All right, those are the early answers. Chuck is correct. It is Hartford. Hartford, Connecticut.
I just wanted to disagree. Let's remember.
You did point that out.
I knew he was right.
You're recovering your Hicksville education. Johnny Cash recorded a number of live albums at what unusual institutions? Chuck said Folsom Prison. we'll give him credit because it's unusual institutions. He played several prisons, and he released live albums from different prisons. But, yeah, and everybody pretty much got that one. Yep, okay. Who played Popeye in the live-action version of Popeye? Everybody got Robin Williams. So everybody's doing pretty well so far. I'm impressed. The Same-Sex Marriage Act was signed into law by which New York governor? You guys both said the senior Cuomo, the elder Cuomo. Fremda says that gay governor guy. Vicky says the dude before Cuomo. No, it's Andrew Cuomo. June of 2011. So not the father, but the son.
Junior, huh?
Junior. Well, he wasn't junior, right? The father was Mario.
It
wasn't Mario.
Mario.
It
was Mario. Right. But I'm just saying the junior.
But the son. The son. In June of 2011, which I didn't realize he was governor that long.
Yes, because I remember it from Modern Family. They had an episode about how they passed it, and they were all happy.
Okay. All right.
So it's a mountain. So
that show is hysterical.
Yes.
Who was the winningest active Major League Baseball manager before he retired in 1996? Fremdus is George Costanza. You're correct.
Yeah,
You almost didn't go with it, but it's Tommy Lasorda. So you got that one right.
Nice.
Vicky got that one right. Okay. And now another baseball question. Who is the only major leaguer to play at least 500 games with each of four teams? Houston, Montreal, New York, and Detroit. Carolina says either Guerrero or Batista. Fremda says Mike Tyson. Jeff said Rusty Staub. That is the correct answer.
Yes.
Yep. Yeah, Ryan didn't play. Yeah. He played with...
I agree.
Yeah, he played with the Angels for a long time. But, Rusty, Houston, Montreal, which I believe he had two stints with the Mets, and I believe two stints with the Expos, if I'm not mistaken. But, 500 games with four different teams. That's crazy. Great player, too.
Yeah.
Loved Rusty. And it never came out that he was gay, right? It was speculation for years and years.
I was just going to bring it up. There was always always that halo over his head.
But him and
he bat both sides of the plate.
Yeah, him and Rusty, him and Johnny Bench. I always used to hear that those two.
Johnny
Bench.
I didn't mention that, didn't you?
Yeah. What's that?
I never heard the one about Bench.
Oh, really? You never heard that?
Not Bench.
Oh, okay. Name the first woman to produce a sitcom. You guys agree? It's Penny Marshall. Carol Miner said Tina. She said Julia Louise Dreyfus. Vicky says Tina Fey. Everybody's wrong. It is Betty White.
Wow.
And I don't know what sitcom it was, but I think she had some kind of game show at one point, like a prank show.
Mm.
Okay, where was I? What is a kerfuffle? What is a kerfuffle? Chuck said it's a screw up or a mistake. Carol says it's a mistake. Fremda says it's when you fart on somebody's nose, and that's the end of a sentence. It's not necessarily a mistake. What I have here, it means to make a fuss or a bother, usually when people have different points of view, like what are you shouting for? Why are you making such a big to-do? Why are you making a kerfuffle?
Okay. Hmm.
That's what I have here. And then nobody answered the sex question. Wow, what's some, or did I? I don't know. I don't see it there. True or false? Sex during a woman's period is harmful. The boys here said false. They are correct. There is plenty of scientific evidence to show that that period sex can help alleviate a host of common period related health conditions, including headaches, insomnia, and changes in mood.
Hmm.
So it's actually good for you. So it's messy and kind of gross, but
you gotta stop bitching at you.
Will it?
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know.
When it's over, she remembers why she was mad at you in the first place.
What kind of bloody question is that, says Fremder? Betty White had her own talk show in the 50s, so maybe that. Yeah, maybe. Yeah, she did have a talk show, but she had some kind of prank show at one point, I think maybe in the 60s or something. I was guessing that, but either way, Betty White's the answer there, Carol. So nice job, fellas, with your Tuesday trivia. And again, this is a nice We Are the World moment where you guys were agreeing together on all your answers there.
Well, and while we were doing that, I have to tell you this. Since we're talking about, you know, you falling in the grave and all that stuff.
Okay.
I got this phone call. It's now the second phone call from this family who's calling, clearly calling the wrong number. The other day, this old lady calls, leaves a voicemail, because I'm like, I don't know anybody in Georgia, and I don't know this name.
Yeah.
She's leaving me this long message, because she's talking to her, like, her granddaughter or daughter. Yes, this is, sounds, I'm trying to find, if this is Pine Lawn, trying to find out how much money I owe, but, and I'm like.
Have you looked up Pine Lawn's number? Like, is your number close to them?
You know, it's not really close. In fact, I texted that number that called me.
Okay.
But, you know, the lady was 90. It might have been like a landline.
A landline, yeah.
Who knows?
Yeah.
So now, while we're here, I get another phone call. It must be maybe her son or son-in-law saying, yeah, the name, I don't want to mention her name, but the wife called, buried the wife about 3 years ago. I called to find out the balance is due because it's something the papers say it's like 2,000. I left the number yesterday. I just want to make sure everything's okay with the payment. Okay, have a great day, it says.
What do they do? Dig her up and give her back?
Right. Yeah, you're right. You're late on your payment. Send her back.
Yeah. They're in Georgia. That's where this number's coming from. They're calling me about the balance of Pine Lawn.
You want to call them and we'll, like, maybe we can get them to give us their credit card number.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, there you go. no, it's not 2,000. We'll listen, no, it's 4.
Listen, so I'm glad you called. We were just about to ship it back to you. UPS is on its way. If you don't pay before they get here, she'll be there in 3 days.
Otherwise, we'll toss it back in the ground if you give us the money now. Yeah.
Would you have the balls to do that if I made the call?
Oh, God, I could not do that.
I know, I couldn't do that either. I mean, there are certain comedians that would jump on this.
Yeah.
Like a lady from AT&T called one of the lines here once when Fat Jay was here, and he just went nuts with this lady. Cursing up a storm and like flirting with her, and she went with it for quite a while.
I do that all the time when I get the calls. When I get the calls about the, especially like the solar power. I
right.
This old man voice. Like, yeah. I love solar power. My grandson Bobby works for LIPA. You must know. You know Bobby? Yeah. Of course you know Bobby. Everybody knows Bobby.
Yeah.
And I go on and I go on and I keep him on the phone as long as I can. I just keep going. And go, yeah, me and Bobby go fishing. You ever go fishing with Bobby? You must know Bobby. And I just keep going on and on.
Rodia used to, when he had his show in here, he used to, I think he, there was one time he used to make prank calls live from in there. I think it was Home Depot he called. And he was a very flamboyant Richard Simmons type, right? And he's asking all sorts of weird questions. But then he had his father get on the other extension. And he gets into an argument with himself. And he was going back and forth. Like, he wasn't screwing up the voices. Like, he nailed it. And the guy on the other line is just kind of, it was a girl, actually. She was just trying to diffuse the whole thing. And she was trying to be so nice. But he's, like, cursing at himself and having this fight. Oh, I laughed my ass off. It was great. And the one I always tell, I tell this so many times. We back in the day when there used to be a few of us hosting in here, we had a few people in here. And somebody got a call on their cell, and it said scam likely. So we're like, screw it, let's answer it. So we answered it. And the guy's like, he had the accent. But he supposedly worked for the IRS. And, you know, if you don't pay this money, we're going to, you know, you're going to be fined and all this stuff. But all of a sudden, you hear the guy, the guy's dog barking in the background.
Yeah.
So he immediately hangs up. So we had Sally call that number back from her phone. And the guy answered. And she's like, hi, I got a voicemail that, that I owe this money. And sure enough, he's, oh, yeah, you owe all this money. You did $2,000, whatever it was. And he's going on and on. So we had one of the other guys, Derek Mutispor, Mr. Poppentwist. He was in here, so he pretended to be the husband. Are you spending money again? What are you doing? What did I tell you about giving your credit card information? And then we start, and Sally starts yelling, ow, ow. The freaking guy, he freaked out. Stop it, stop it. He get all excited. And then he starts cursing at us. You son of a bitch, you're a fucking coward. How dare you beat the woman? And he finally says, he goes, I'm going to call the cops. He's like, you're the crook, and you're going to call the cops? And he totally caved. This went on for quite a while. He finally, miss, your credit is fine. You're not getting charged anything. Everything is fine. Don't worry about a thing. Like, he totally caved. like, we totally got this guy. We couldn't believe it. All these scams are probably coming from some guy sitting in a cave in his underwear with the computer and a phone named Deep Fried Shit Patel. Sitting in a cave. Well, Fremder is very racist. Deep Fried Shit Patel. Yeah, you're a racist.
See, when you type on the word processor, you can read it before you hit say.
There you go. All right, it is pretty much time for us to go. So, do you have anything like for your big comeback? What do you got?
I got nothing yet. I sent in the schedule, and I'll wait, and it will toss me a bone here and there. I got the 21st. I'll be in. Well, next week I'll be in Atlantic City.
Oh, nice. Performing or just vacation?
I got that tournament.
Oh, that's right, the poker tournament. Tournament. We didn't even get to that.
Yeah.
Chuck's. Are you a poker guy?
Yeah.
Are you?
Yeah,
I'm not. I've never gotten
the Borgata. The Borgata. I forget what the hell you have some name for it.
Poker place.
Mega something.
Yeah. Yeah, but you're a major player, huh?
I play a lot.
Yeah. What's the most you've ever won?
13,000.
Holy shit.
That's
nice. You ever won anything like that? Do you play to that extent?
No.
Yeah.
No, but the general ones around here, they run. When you go into the weeklies, because you wind up chopping them up with like three or four guys.
Right, okay.
When you all get down to the end. And you come up with 2,000 to 4,000 in
so
that range.
This may sound totally ignorant, but again, I don't play. So how do you chop it up? I mean, it comes down to one winner.
Well, what happened? No, they'll pay first, second, third, fourth.
Okay.
Okay. And then when it gets down to five guys, everybody agrees to take money out of each level.
Yeah.
And give the fifth guy like his money back, like we call it the bubble.
Oh.
Okay, so that's almost automatic. So if you get down, if they're paying four and you're number five, you pretty much, the guys are going to say, okay, listen, let's give this guy his money back.
Oh, that's cool.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
And then you play it, and depending upon how many chips everybody has, if everybody's all the same, you're going to be there for hours.
Right.
So they add up what's left, you know. So let's say first prize is 4,000, second prize is 2,000, 3,000, 1,000, like that.
Right.
You just add everything up together and divide it by four. Or,
oh, okay.
And chop it up
cool.
That way. Or three or two or one, you know. And it varies from 20. Some guys don't want to chop, and then you go to the end. But most people, when you get down at least, I rarely see when it gets down to at least two, when the guys take first and second and just,
right.
You know, just split it.
Yeah.
And that's Atlantic City, that's when? Next week? 2 weeks?
It starts Wednesday. And it basically, you got to make each day. So if you make it through the first day, you go to the second day. You make it through the second day, you go to the third day.
Okay.
You make it through the third day, and you're making some nice money.
And so you could go up Mohegan Sun and make it to the next level and win some money.
Well, I don't know. If I do that, that's the week before, basically.
Yeah.
So I got to go to Atlantic City 1 week and Mohegan Sun the next week. I'm either going to be very rich or very poor.
No, but that's what I'm saying. When you go to Mohegan Sun, you could possibly advance and then gamble while you're there. So you could get both there.
Yeah, both ends.
Win-win.
Both ends. Both well, that's ends. That's both something ends. If that's what you do there too, that's, you know.
Going in a whole new direction.
Just 5 minutes spot in Mohegan Sun cost me a few grand.
Exactly. You bringing the wife or no?
I don't know. I have a friend who's up there. He may come down, but I don't know. She's comedied out.
She's what?
Comedied out.
Oh, comedied out. Yeah, she's sick of your act.
I mean, she's hundreds of shows. And
sure, because that's a trifecta. You know, you make it to the next level, win some cash, and get the loving.
Yeah. Well, they're two different places. Don't forget, I go to Atlantic City first, then I got to go to Mohegan Sun.
Yeah, but no, isn't Mohegan Sun? Don't they have?
That's up in. Yeah, they have the gambling.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about. Yeah, I mean, yeah, you might win at Atlantic City too, but I'm just talking about Mohegan. You could win.
Yep.
Well, money get
dance.
To the right.
That's it.
But that's what I'm saying, though. Bring the wife. You get the trifecta. Win money, make it to the next round of Last Comic Standing, and get the loving. I mean, then you can kill yourself after that because it's downhill from there. All right. So do you feel the need to get on stage, like, before the Last Comic? Like, do you feel like you need to hone some skills?
I may hit a couple mics if I don't get any spots.
Yeah.
Because this weekend's up already. Next weekend's shot. In a weekend, I come back.
Right. Yeah.
So. If not, I'll just do it. I'll do the set in my car.
Right.
For 3 hours.
And speaking of which, it says Better Business Bureau. Let's see what they say.
Oh.
Hello. Wow, they hung up already. All right.
So much
for that. All right, so and you'll be coming back on here after that. So all the best.
So and whatever we'll, is after the 21st, the 22nd, 23rd.
So we'll, whatever, any of those. Hopefully we won't see you that week because that means you're advancing and everything.
No, you'll see me that week because it'll be over Sunday.
All right.
Do the math.
So I had a brain fart. So looking forward to seeing you then, and hopefully it'll be some good news, and we'll be pulling for you. All the best, and glad to see you back up in action. Glad your eyes are okay. And then this guy over here, you make this a regular thing again.
Absolutely.
All right. And that's it. So thanks for sticking with us today for Tuesday Trivia. We are back here on Thursday, me and Brandon, and I don't know if I have a guest yet. On Friday, me and Andy will be Zooming with, I haven't even told Andy yet. We have a singer called Jan Close, or Jan Close. It might be Jan Close. He called in once before. We had a good time with him. He's a singer. He has an album out, so I figured let's bring him back. So we'll be Zooming with him. And that's it. We got Hershey and the Keegs tonight at 9 o'clock. They'll have, they got Eric Haft joining them. Tomorrow night at 7, Circling the Drain with Ira and Pickles and Sean and Dakota, Carolina rather. And then tomorrow night at 8:30, Why You Like This with Carla, Rich, and Tim. And then, like I said, we'll be back here Thursday. All right, everybody have a great day, and we'll see you guys later. Don't forget, like I mentioned yesterday, Drinks, Jokes, and Storytelling with Mark Riccadonna and Richie Byrne starts here on Gov's Comedy Club podcast on May 15th. So make sure you join us for that. That's going to be great. Here's a little teaser of that show. We'll see you guys later.
Bartlett, ladies and gentlemen.
Rob Bartlett!
Rich Voss is here. Rich Voss.
Mark DeMeo right here. How about it, Mark DeMeo?
Jim Grumbier.
Carrie Carabas.
Carrie.
Chris Roach, everybody.
Chris Roach. Give it up to Lisa Lampanelli. How about it?
Lisa.
Danny. Richie. Benavini.
Don Jameson.
Oh, yeah. The only Vanessa Hollingshead. How about it?
Woo! Rick Overton.
Yes, Rick Overton. Hey. Mr. Joey Cola. How about that?
Joey Cola is a... Oh, boy. He already forgot. He already forgot us on. That's how old he is. He was... Hey, Joey!
Joey!
Well, I hear them, but I don't see them.
Joey!
We're inside the china cabinet.
Well, look to your left, to your right, or wherever. I don't know. It's back.
Hey, we're on your computer.
Hey!
Oh, there you are!